Nobody knows what's around the corner. Life can be taken away on the turn of a sixpence. But as long as there are people who are prepared to come out of their door every morning and try and help other people, you have got to feel hope.
Hello, Queens. Oh, Jesus.
Adult and a trauma call.
Been stabbed twice in the chest.
Fall from parachute, hard landing.
Collapse on a football pitch.
Charge to 360. Excellent.
Thank you very much. Please call again.
Queen's Medical Centre, Nottingham.
Hey up, Ducky.
Another day in paradise.
One of the busiest A&E departments in Europe.
Wow!
That, I don't think, is survivable.
Have we got a new one coming in?
3 minutes.
There is no room at the inn.
Do you want anything to drink? Cup of tea?
This place is awesome.
A place where life...
Ding, ding.
You're a happy band of people here.
Love.
Love your kids.
And loss.
Can't fruit and food.
Unfold every single day.
Working in A&E, you see people in those worst moments of their life.
My baby boy, I can't lose my baby boy.
But there are always stars in the black sky.
Oh, my darling.
It makes you realise how important life is, and we should hang on to that with both hands.
Have you?
Filmed across one 24-hour period, these are the stories of a nation and its health service.
Thank you for everything.
Oh.
Suddenly, a lot of the things that you thought mattered doesn't matter.
It's okay.
But you're there for me and I'm there for you. And that's a strong bond.
I'm loving you too.
Bless you.
Bless you.
It's hell on earth, let me tell you.
I know, now it's like, yeah, because everyone's just dropping like flies and off sick and stuff.
Oh, do you know how boring it is just waiting here? Actually, no, you do, because you are here.
Look up there for me and open your mouth big and wide.
I think I have two parts to me. There's this bit that seems quite confident, quite self-assured.
I'm on it. Like a car bonnet.
Like a car bonnet.
And then there's this, you know, maybe little Ian that was found life quite tricky.
He's allergic to chloramphenicol.
Is he?
Mm-hmm.
How do you know that?
Gave fusidic acid ointment as allergic to chloramphenicol.
Oh, didn't read that.
That's why I'm a registrar.
Yeah, because you can read.
Growing up, I felt that I wouldn't achieve anything and that I was rubbish.
Pediatrics.
You know, the problem is the things that you learn when you're little, they stick with you, don't they?
I'm just preparing for the worst. I always prepare for the worst. Queen's Reese, was Lauren speaking? An archery arrow. Oh, lots of blood. Any loss of consciousness? Significant swelling to his eye and cheek. Oh. Are his abs okay? I'm just gonna put you through to peds. All right, 1 minute.
Hello.
It's Lauren. In adult research, I've got a 15-year-old guy who's walked into an archery arrow.
Okay. And is it gone into his eye?
He's got an arrow in his eye, penetrating eye injury. Okay.
When you hear that someone's got an eye injury and they're coming to us rather than to eye casualty, there's always a bit of, okay, that's really unusual. This isn't going to be a little scratch in their eye. There's something more going on, something quite big.
It looks like he's got soft tissue injury here, but his eye's closed and swollen, so they can't really see.
If it's gone into your eye and through the back, it's not far to your brain, and that can be life-changing, life-ending.
The 15-year-old boy's mother was with him when the accident happened and is travelling in the ambulance.
We were on holiday, and we went to the archery activity. I didn't see it happen. Somebody came over to me and said, I think there's a problem with your son. I looked over, and James was crumpled on the floor, and he was holding his left eye. I ran over to him, and it was just horrific. The blood was pouring out of his eye, out of his nose. It was just everywhere.
Becca, do you need another pair of hands? James, I'm Ian. I'm one of the doctors.
There's nothing worse than seeing your own child bleeding and injured.
If you ignore your face, is anywhere else hurt? Anywhere else causing some troubles?
No.
Okay. And it looks like you had a nosebleed. Your latus not a lot. Has been bleeding out of his nose. Okay. If anyone tries to put anything in your nose, say no, all right?
All right.
If it's a swab or anything.
You know, the top of your nose, up here, your brain sits on top of that bone. So if you've got a break there and you put something in somebody's nose, it can go up into the skull, into where your brain is.
So there's going to be lots of stuff that we're going to do, OK? Sometimes I'll do something and you'll be like, well, what are you doing? Yeah. Just say. I'm going to look at your good eye for a moment first. OK?
Oh, I can see again.
Brilliant. So...
yeah, it comes with a bad eye.
OK.
Not to move too much.
Cover this side for a moment. Can you look at my name badge?
No, can't read that.
Can you read it with...
No.
No? Can you see my picture?
No.
No? Can you see my hand?
No.
Now your eyes are a bit more open. Can you read my name badge?
No.
Okay.
15-year-old James has been struck in the eye with an arrow.
Your question to yourself is the globe, is the eyeball itself, you know, irretrievably damaged? And that means that they'll never have that vision again in that eye.
We don't want you to try and look around too much. Try and keep both of your eyes relatively still. We're going to do a scan of your head to find out where the injury is. OK? Right, I'm just going to feel around your face a moment.
OK.
Feel OK?
Yeah.
That's hematoma that's run down.
Just going to wipe your nose a little bit so we can just try and establish where is actively bleeding.
It's going to push up on your chin, all right? How's that feel?
That's fine.
Okay. The eyeball itself is called the globe, and I'm not sure what damage has been done or not to that. So I think if we do a scan, it will help us identify where the injury is, but we'll have a think about could there be a broken bone in there as well. Right. Are you all right with people like... I've often put my hand on people's shoulder. Are you all right with that sort of stuff?
Yeah, fine.
OK, good.
James was born in July of 2006. He was just this tiny, red, chubby little face. He was beautiful. He used to love to play with our little Chihuahua dog. He used to laugh at her endlessly. And he was just a happy-go-lucky little kid.
Okay, we're going that way.
But I always sort of knew that there was something different about James. He was just a little bit slow on a lot of his milestones, especially when it came to talking.
Are you all right going backwards?
Yeah.
Because I'm definitely better at steering going backwards.
He struggled with friendships. He wasn't the kid that got invited to all the, you know, the birthday parties and such. And this really bothered me. This really upset me. But it never seemed to really bother James. That would have been the first major sign of his differences.
Hello.
Hello.
James, so we need you on the stable here, right?
It wasn't until James was around 7 or 8 and we were living in the UK that he got his diagnosis of autism.
Sounds very futuristic. Oh, a bit further up.
There was a lot of emotions going on. A good portion of it was relief because it was that confirmation of everything that I'd felt and thought his entire life.
You just need to stay very, very still, okay, James?
Okay.
When you've got like a lot of emotion in a child who doesn't understand how to process that, it can come out in unexpected ways.
Well done, that's it, that's all done.
All right.
When he was a lot younger, around the age of 5, he would hurt himself. He would smash his head against a wall or a door or a hard surface when he was experiencing strong emotions. That has happened recently as well, during high school hours, which has been difficult for him.
How did it feel being in that scanner machine?
Didn't feel that bad. It's just a bit warm.
It's heartbreaking to deal with a child who's going through something that is so obviously painful for them.
Hi.
It's upsetting because you know that they're going to have a struggle in their lives.
Carrying my chest of drawers down the stairs. And I've got my nipples pierced. It's a bit embarrassing. My boob got caught in between the wall and the drawers. And next minute I just see my nipple bar on the floor like this.
Oh, God.
And I look down and my nipples were like split in half. Just seen blood everywhere, and I'd see it hurts. Oh. I'm hoping I don't need stitches because that's a very sensitive area.
It is.
I smashed my head out on my doorframe at work. Said to me, "Did you not yet?" And I went, "No, you're joking, man. Where I was, if I'd woke up, I'd have had no tools left."
The way I hit it was like someone had hit me with a sledgehammer on the head.
I love the beer.
Yeah, well, it's green today, yeah.
I felt myself go in and I was going unconscious and all I could think about was it was an opportunity for a TikTok video.
Just banged my head at work. Oh. Oh, God, that hurts.
Christopher.
That's me.
Hello.
Hello.
I've got 22,000 followers now.
There you go, you take a seat.
It's good, it's a good laugh. It really is. It's, everyone should try it.
I'm Naomi, one of the nurse practitioners.
Hiya.
So what's happened to you?
So I was at work, putting something down a chute, bent down to get something, just proper head-butted the door frame.
Oh, right, OK. What kind of job do you do?
I'm a joiner.
Joiner. So I'm just going to have a quick look at you, is that all right?
Yeah.
Get my gloves on.
My family, they describe me, lad, probably, centre of attention. But when I was a kid, if you didn't shout so much, you never got heard.
Ouch.
I was born in a place called Snenton in Nottingham. I'm the last of 9 children. 4 sisters, 4 brothers, and I'm the baby. They all say I ain't got telly in the house, but...
I tell you what, I didn't off-bang it.
One stage, there was a full household. There were boys in one side and girls in the other. And I had to wait until my brother got married so he could move out of his bed. I'd come out the cot. I think I was in the cot till I was about 3.
Lift your eyebrows up for me, keep them there, and don't let me pull them down.
We used to have one radiator in the house. It'd be a fight to get to the radiator because it was freezing. There was always someone banging on the bathroom door to get in. We had a tin bath with an hole at one end, with a brick under it. And Mum used to put us in the bath. And bearing in mind, I'd be like, last one in.
What's the green?
Green beer?
Yeah.
It changes colour every, I try and do it every 2 weeks.
Do you?
Yeah.
What's the reason behind that?
I've just been doing it for 3 years. It's different, isn't it?
Yeah. Matches your earring.
Oh, everything's got to match. My mum was the kingpin of the family. Only about 5'5". She always had black curly hair. It was weird having an older mum, because everyone thought she was my grandma.
So at the moment, I can't see any reason to x-ray.
Is it being stitched or green?
I think I'll ask them to see if they can stitch it, maybe.
But I always have such a big scar.
You get a scar regardless.
Listen, you can't ruin these gorgeous looks, you know. Okay. Everyone was scared of me dad. My older brothers, they was petrified of him when he was when he got into one of his moods right like that. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
If you got the wrong side of him, he'd give you a good walloping.
I don't trust people. They nick your dinner.
They do.
They nick the feta out your salad.
Did you?
No, it wasn't me, but it was someone else who was on shift.
No.
I remember there was someone, they'd made like a chicken salad wrap and they got the wrap out of the fridge for lunch and someone had taken the chicken.
No,
but left everything else. I know. People don't have shame, do they?
I don't understand it.
Queen's Recess, Lauren speaking. 70-year-old male flipped his car.
Yeah.
Shoulder injury.
Yeah.
See spine tenderness. Hey. Perfect. How long are you going to be?
Thank you. Bye.
Half an hour.
Yeah.
A 70-year-old man is being rushed to Queen's Medical Centre after crashing his car and flipping it onto its roof.
What? So the car's rolled?
Yes.
Yeah.
Major trauma nurse Zoe is on shift in Resus.
So when you hear that it's a car rollover, you automatically think traumatic brain injury, organ injuries, internal bleeding, spinal cord injuries.
A right shoulder injury.
And C-spine tenderness, so collar unblocked.
So C-spine injury is a injury to someone's neck.
Can we get trauma mattress, please?
They could have kind of spinal cord injury. Could be really serious. Their lives could just be changed in an instant.
Amy, you all right to go in three in a minute for trauma?
The man's brother was at work when he received the call.
It was dark, grey day, a bit wet and showery, a typical late September, autumny day. There were leaves on the road. I was working at a wind turbine farm. Jim's daughter phoned me, she sounded panicky. Very, very worried. She said, Dad's been involved in a really bad accident. I've seen it, we were following him in the car.
Green trauma in three, coming in about 10 minutes.
He rolled the car and he ended up upside down in the ditch.
Are you doing primary day?
The roof was caved in, he was trapped. I thought he would have spinal injuries, head injuries. An off-duty first responder was the first vehicle to stop and offer help, so that was some consolation. But she said, don't know how bad he is, and we can't move him. I said to my colleague, I need to go. Then I realised that I was shaking. There's no way I was going to be able to drive.
Trauma.
I felt helpless.
Jim, what we're going to do, we're going to get you onto the hospital bed now, all right?
Like the world stopped still. Just felt numb.
On three, one, two, three, lift.
Good job.
So this is Jim, so he's 70 years old. He was travelling at approximately 40 miles an hour. hit a ditch, hit a tree, rolled over. Okay, we've extracted him. Fire got him down, then we've extracted him out. We've got a right shoulder injury, a cut laceration to the hand there. He has got bony tenderness, C-spine. 5 milligrams morphine, 1 gram paracetamol, he's had 4 milligrams of ondansetron as well.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
So we're probably going to go for a scan shortly, Jim.
Jim, I'm there with one of the other trauma nurses.
Older patients, they're more frail. They can come in and initially they seem okay, the numbers are good, and then they can sometimes deteriorate pretty quickly.
I was following my daughter.
Yeah.
And she just see it roll over and over into the ditch.
Where's your daughter now?
She's on her way.
She's on her way.
Cool.
I phoned my wife, said, you can't do anything, there's no point you going to the hospital. Just felt really sick. I thought I had lost my brother.
Is your pain all right?
Yeah. Just hurts, so obviously when I move.
Where does it hurt?
On top of my neck.
Top of your neck.
70-year-old Jim is being taken for an urgent CT scan after he flipped his car onto its roof.
Hello. Jim and I grew up in Somerby, a village in Leicestershire. We had a really good family life.
OK, just move you across to our table, OK?
OK.
I think we're going to turn. Ready, steady, turn. I'm back.
Mum and Dad, elder sister, Carol. Me, younger brother, Jim. We would enjoy going for walks on a Sunday afternoon in the countryside, living the full village life. But then it was shattered.
OK, you just have to stay very nice and still for the scan.
Yeah.
I'd just turned 8 years old. Our father was working on a farm building and he fell through a barn roof and hit the concrete floor below. And unfortunately, he died from a broken skull.
Just stay nice and still.
Jim, being 2 years old, would hardly know what was really going on at all. It was just dreadful. We were dealing with grief, but we had no income. So my sister took on a fatherly role at the age of 14. She left school and went to work in the local village grocery shop. She really helped support the family financially and caring-wise, and lost a lot of her teenage life as a result of it.
Breathe in and hold your breath.
She wasn't compromising herself, it came natural to her. Jim really always looked up to her right from the age of 2.
Pop your glasses back on again.
Thank you.
He just saw Carol as a second mother, really.
Right, thanks a lot, I'm sure we'll see you soon.
Yeah. Jim relied on Carol a lot. She was the go-to person to discuss any issues he had. Carol put family first and herself last.
Excuse me. Thank you.
My sister was taken into a hospital at Derby on Monday.
OK.
With COVID. Pneumonia. She's really suffering.
Oh dear.
Her husband rang me yesterday and said, oh, I've got some bad news that Carol's not responding to the oxygen or something.
Oh, bless you, that's scary.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
So I didn't sleep at all well last night.
Yeah, worrying.
Didn't.
That is so sad.
I've never seen someone of this stuff before.
I don't think they get these kind of cases often. But who knows? Maybe they do. We are in Robin Hood country.
James is awaiting the results of a head scan after an arrow penetrated his eye socket in an archery accident.
We need to give you a tetanus vaccine. It's an injection into the muscle of your arm. You've not missed any vaccinations or anything, as far as you're aware.
It's difficult because I'm just struggling to remember, because that's just something that my brain doesn't.
That's okay.
I have also dyspraxia, so it makes things like that difficult to remember.
All the best people do.
Do you as well?
I'm dyspraxic, so you know.
You know what I mean.
Yeah.
No,
neurodiversity hangs together. I'm quite open with my patients. I have some neurodiversity of my own. I have some problems with dyslexia, and I've just been diagnosed with ADD. Attention deficit disorder means that sometimes you have problems with focus. Just settling down to do something, it's almost like asking someone to walk up a cliff. Hi, I'm one of the paediatric registrars in TDD. I've got a 15-year-old who has leant forward onto a static arrow that was embedded in a target. Growing up, I had quite a few difficulties, especially at school. I didn't feel like I fitted in. I didn't have that many friends. I was much more of a loner.
Yeah. And then we'll send him around to eye casualty on the way through.
People tell you that, you know, you're stupid, that you're not going to achieve anything. My teacher said that I wouldn't do my GCSEs because I wasn't intelligent enough. I think I felt like I constantly had to prove to people that I wasn't stupid.
James, at the moment, if you sneeze or cough, you mustn't pinch your nose or hold it in, because I don't want you to put the pressure in your body up. Does that make sense?
Parts of people's lives can be really difficult. For me, it's really hard sometimes.
This is an accident emergency, OK? We've got people here dying, so take a seat and I'll get someone to talk to you.
Is it Christopher?
Yes, it is.
Want to come through?
50-year-old Chris is having treatment for a head wound following an accident at work.
Hiya, I'm Christine, I'm one of the nurses.
Hi, Christine.
Just take a seat on that trolley for me. So I'm just going to be having a little gander at your wound.
Busy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Couldn't believe some of the things people come in for. Woman come in with a sore throat. That was it.
Yeah, it's crazy. Have you been listening at the desk then?
Yeah, I've been sat at the desk listening to it.
Do you know what? I could sit on that reception desk all day. So, yeah, I'm just going to give it a good clean.
Yeah.
And just see whether we can get away with glue or yes. Need stitches.
Yeah, my last video of this, no.
What, having it done?
Yeah.
Ooh, I don't know.
I'll make you famous on TikTok.
Oh, God, I'm not into TikTok. My daughter's into that. It's not my thing. You can feel my hands. Right, so I'm going to localise you.
Yeah.
I like making people laugh, yeah.
You ready?
Yeah.
You sure you want to film it?
Yeah, go on.
When you're in a house of 9 people, you fight for attention. Because I was always a bit of a joker when I was younger. But you wouldn't want to mess with me, Dad.
Okay. So it's going to sting a bit.
Yeah. We knew to keep out of his way. My mum would say if he's been down to the pub or out like that, don't meet him on the landing. God help you. Especially when I was bad. Oh, God. Oh. I remember one night waking up and I wanted a wee, and I went out onto the landing and I met him on the landing, and he'd been to the pub and he seen me and he gave me a good hiding that night. I'll never forget that one. I remember going to school the next day and I'd got pain everywhere.
Yeah, can't feel it now.
Yeah.
Brilliant, isn't it?
My mum made up for all that. She hit him on the head with a saucepan once. Literally.
It's deep, isn't it?
Give it a couple of stitches, I reckon.
She was always, always there, giving you lots of kisses and looking after you, and constantly, always. She's always there for us, she was. Bless her. She was so loving, and she just couldn't give you enough love, really.
You feel that?
No.
Sometimes when you look at it, I think it makes you feel it.
Well, it don't bother me.
Does it not? Some people can't bear to look at it.
It's quite good watching it. Was you good at textiles at school?
No, do you know what? Absolutely crap.
Do you reckon it'll be a nice scar?
Well, it will be a scar, like, but it, I mean, it'll fade over time. It won't be too bad. Yeah, it's all right, isn't it?
Yeah, it'll crack in. Come out of job in time.
Yeah, can leave that.
My mum passed away 8 years ago. Still miss her. Well's milk now, thinking about it.
You can have them taken out in about 7 days.
Can't wash me hair?
Can't wash your hair, no.
No.
Every year on my mum's birthday and that, we all go up and to see my mum and we all stand around the grave and sing to her, "You Are My Sunshine," and we all have a meal together and catch up.
Is that it, then?
Yeah, you're free to go. All right.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
Appreciate that.
My mum taught me how to love. She taught me how to be kind to people. And try and keep smiling as much as you can.
Do you want to set up a hotspot for you? It's a hotspot. It's for my data on my phone.
Oh.
I have 200 gigabytes. You have no gigabytes.
No. Yeah, but it's not very often people come in with split nipples.
I have seen it once before.
Oh, okay.
These things do happen.
It's really, really hurting.
Sorry. So it's already started to heal, actually. Sorry. I'm gonna put dressing on it.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
From the intracranial images that we have, there doesn't appear to be any intracranial injury.
Yeah.
Dr. Ian now has the results of James's head scan.
There are some fractures to the maxillary sinus on the left.
Yeah.
Involved in the orbit.
Thank you very much. That's really helpful.
If you've fractured the bones at the back of the eye, then those bony fragments can damage the optic nerve. If the optic nerve is damaged enough, that will cause blindness.
So the plan at the moment is for him to go for eye casualty.
Okay.
Okay. And then they will take on that ongoing care. We're going to try and work out if there's any underlying fracture, get some idea what the globe is up to. It will be all right. You'll be fine.
Yeah.
Just be kind to yourself. Look after yourself.
Mm.
Give yourself a little internal hug.
Okay.
And but you'll be fine. You'll work it out.
The world can be a real challenge. And often feel quite sad. This year has been really difficult for a lot of people, and I found it really tricky. I was getting a lot of problems with anxiety and low mood, and I was in a really, really dark place, and I had to have some time off work. I guess it's really difficult because you're there for other people so much, sometimes you forget to be there for yourself.
Right, it's good. They might dig in a little bit, but... Fine.
That's it. They look all right, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're in place.
Jim crashed and rolled his car. Clinicians are awaiting the results of the CT scan of his head and neck. His daughter, Sherry, witnessed the accident from another car.
So he's just in here. Look who I brought to see you. Don't move your head.
I can't move my head.
No.
Hey.
Hello, Lola. How
are you doing, Dad?
All right, yeah.
Yeah? So I've just been and quickly looked at your scans.
Yeah.
There's nothing obvious, so that's a good sign.
Oh, lovely, thank you.
Okay, so I can take these off you now.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But that's good news, because it was your shoulder and everything, wasn't it?
So, yeah, no, probably just bruised.
You're probably just going to be aching and a bit sore for the next couple of days.
OK.
No, Doc, it must have been horrible for you.
Yeah, but worse for you.
Looking in your mirror and seeing me. Did it? Well, I see it flipped over, but...
Mm-hmm.
What, just once or two or three times?
You rolled a couple of times and ended up upside down.
Upside down in the ditch.
Gonna have to tell you.
Yeah?
I'm gonna have to tell you.
What's that?
Auntie Carol's not doing so well.
Oh.
I had to tell you. Okay? I can't not tell you. Okay.
Our sister Carol never complained about going to work at 14. And I can remember carrying on, working the allotments, helping out with the housework at home. If you got any concerns, you could talk to her and just cry in front of her and she'd cuddle you. She'd take care of you at that age. It's like having two mums, really. And she was a really, really good mum. Never changed throughout her life. Even after we'd grown up and her own family had grown up, she was always wanting to know how things were. If I needed somebody to talk to, she was always there to listen.
What did Terry say?
John's going to let us know more when he can. Apparently, Auntie Carol sends her love to everyone and wants us all to remember how she was.
OK?
That's the message.
Family is very important. If it's a close-knit family, like we are, it's the best thing in the world. And especially if your family are your friends as well, then that's top-notch.
Right. OK, Dad?
All right, no, thank you. Take care.
Carol has just given just the memories of a lifetime. She was everything to us. She's like the figurehead of the family.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you feeling?
I've just got a little bit of a headache.
A little bit of a headache.
Yeah, other than that, don't feel too bad.
Sure. So we'll give you we can give you some painkillers for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. I've just been having a look at the CT scan report that you've had.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't look like there's any significant injuries. So we should be able to let you go home.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've just had some bad news though, didn't we? My elder sister got COVID and pneumonia.
You won't have been able to see your sister since she's gone into hospital.
3 or 4 months ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. Things aren't looking very good at all.
I'm really sorry to hear that.
Yeah. So, thank you, Doc.
Jim is going to a day ward until he is ready to be discharged from hospital.
Right, let's rock and roll. Get you out of this madhouse.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't believe what's happened this last 24 hours. Yeah.
Sometimes life really sort of takes it all out of you and you just feel like you've been through the ringer, and that's really hard. For me, you know, it's giving that, you know, that little Ian a bit of a hug and saying it's going to be OK and muddling your way forward and getting there. I don't walk around thinking maybe I'm a role model for people, but if people can see that despite some difficulties, then you can still do okay, or more than okay, then that would be really amazing. If I look back on that 12-year-old that was told that they wouldn't get their GCSEs, well, you know, I've come a bloody long way. And I've climbed some really big mountains. And I just need to remind myself to look at the view from time to time.
But maybe we should put this on your other finger, huh? Because... Uh-oh.
You should have probably left it alone.
I should have, yes.
James has been referred to an eye specialist to assess the damage to his eye.
James? We're going to pop you on a wheelchair, OK? And take you round to the eye casualty.
my graphic art teacher. He's blind in one eye.
Is he?
Yeah.
Oh. But it hasn't stopped him, has it? No.
If something like that happens, we can work around it and work with it. Yeah. And you can have a successful life. But don't think you need to think of that just at the moment. Right, we're short on nurses and porters, so you're going to have a really bad driver. OK.
Autism is just a different way that the brain works. We've always been very positive about it. It's not a negative thing.
I don't know why it was still on.
Because your nurse was terrible. I was your nurse.
One of the things that I love most about James is just how sensitive and caring and loving he is.
Okay.
He is a wonderful person with his own unique set of skills and attributes and wonderful things about him.
We're going that way.
He's also incredibly creative and very imaginative.
Oh, look, there's fish.
He loves to create Lego and he can create pretty much anything out of Lego. And he wants to be an author. He wants to write stories. He amazes me on a daily basis. He's so precious.
So, James, how's your vision at the moment? Well, this is swollen shut, so... Yeah, it's very difficult to see. All right, let's take that off for the time being. So, should we bring this towards you? And then I'll let Miss Pradeep have a look.
Am I hurting you? Can you look down for me, James? Excellent.
I think that any parent worries about how the world will receive their child. The experience that they're gonna have, the heartbreaks, you know, the jobs, the losses.
Thank you, James.
I want him to be fulfilled. I want him to find connections with people that enrich his life. I just want happiness for him.
The eyeball is intact as far as we can see. We think there might be a small fracture in one of the orbital bones, which is the facial bone.
Okay, James, so if you pop your chin forward again, we're gonna put some drops in that left eye to make the pupil larger, and then we'll have a look at the back of your eyes and make sure that there isn't anything there, any swelling or bleeding as well. If you've got bleeding around the eye, we don't want the nerve to be compressed. All done. Try and open your eyes as much as you can. That's good. Can you look all the way up for me? That's good. Perfect. So, the back of the eye is fine. And there's no constriction of the optic nerve. So that's probably the main thing that we wanted to see. So you've got a little cut at the top. I think it will need some stitches in. All right.
Yes, he is different. He's unique. And the way that he's going to go through life is going to be different. But the way that he embraces life, it's a beautiful thing.
James is being taken to a ward to await an operation on his damaged eyelid.
Literally, within 2 weeks, it all healed up, and you wouldn't even know I've cut my head open.
Still catch good looks.
Yeah, the Irish smile's still there. What has life taught me so far? It goes very fast. It's not all about the money. It's not all about what house you've got or what car you've got. It's about enjoying yourself and having fun.
When I got home from the hospital, I had a message to say that Carol was still struggling. Still don't think it's hit home yet. You know. She was always there. Religiously, once a week, she used to ring up and just see how I was getting on. But I can still hear her voice on the phone. I can't get that out of my mind. Sorry. Carol was a rock to me. She got us through okay.
I don't know what I would have done if I lost sight in one eye. It's a really difficult thing to think of, losing something that you're used to always having. I think I've been very lucky, but what this experience has taught me is to not do archery. I plan to be an author and write stories. I would say I'm a pretty creative person. Autism is like being a superhero. You've got your superpowers, like being more creative, having good imagination. But like every superhero, they have their weaknesses. Like me, struggling to have this conversation.
Exploring a conspicuous and scandalous ride to the top by talking to both friends and enemies, the rise and fall of Boris Johnson starts tomorrow at 9. And we're with some of the toughest critics in the game slightly later this week. The Gogglebox crew's reviews land Friday at 10. Next, the fight for an inclusion revolution continues in New Model Agency.